Thank you so much, Muzi. Fam, we have clapped before, but let's clap again. He did phenomenal on his debut. Thank you, Muzi, for hosting us really well. Appreciate that. I enjoyed our time of worship. I enjoyed our time of prayer. I enjoy this time of fellowship. It's been an awesome morning so far. Let's continue the awesomeness by jumping into God's Word. Really excited this morning to talk to you guys about family. Before we do that, let me pray. And before I pray, let me just say, I know that question of the day was risky. I know. Every now and then, we have to push the envelope a little bit in terms of vulnerability and openness between people. And we also have to push the envelope just a little bit to help us to share stuff that might be sensitive and hurtful. So just every now and then, okay, not every Sunday. But I knew. So just saying family, and just having the conversations you guys had, I know that some stuff might have come up. So let's pray that we would be focused as we open up God's Word. Lord Jesus, we want to be like you. And we want to treat other people like you treat us. We want to learn from your Word. We want your Spirit to enlighten us and to inspire us, to bring us clarity, to bring conviction. We want to leave here fed and pumped up and filled with your Spirit and with the truth of your Word. We want to be salt and light as we leave this place. We want to be sent. We want to do our part to fulfill the Great Commission. And because of all of these things, Lord Jesus, we now pray that you speak to us through your Word. We seek wisdom, and for wisdom we come to your Word. So I want to pray now that whatever it is that's floating around in our hearts and in our heads, that we would bring that into submission under your Word and under your will. And I pray that you would heal where we need healing. I pray that you would give us wisdom where we need it. I pray all of that in your name, Lord Jesus. Amen. We're busy with a series called God's World, God's Way, the wisdom of Proverbs. Everything in the world is God's, and He has a will for everything. So if you live God's way in God's world, you live a life of wisdom. That's what this series is all about. And for us to receive or to gain this wisdom, we are studying the book of Proverbs, which is a book known as wisdom literature. It is designed to teach us wisdom. Let me give you this little reminder of what Proverbs is and how the book of Proverbs works. I think this is really important for us, especially as we start our sermon today. Proverbs equals probabilities. Okay, so look at it. It says, the fear of God and wisdom will lead to things going great. A probability. It also says, no fear of God and foolishness will lead to things going poorly. That is a real probability. What's important to know about Proverbs, though, is that Proverbs does not equal promises. It's possible for you to live according to the wisdom of Proverbs and still have things go poorly. It is very possible because of the broken state of the world we live in and because of sin. So you might say, I am following this wisdom to the letter, but things are still not flourishing. And then another important remark is Proverbs focus on the general rule and not the exception. And the reason why I'm saying that is because I know so many of you sit here with the exception when it comes to family and not the general rule. That's also why we have books like Ecclesiastes and Job. They focus the wisdom on the things that we could call exceptions. I love this little tag from the Bible Project. It says, life is too complex for formulas. We need all the wisdom books together when we read them. Okay? So just a reminder of what we are busy with. Now, let's be honest. We all long for bottom left. All of us long for things to go great. And that's why we look for wisdom. So today we'll talk about family. Here's why family matters. Because as Christians, we have a very specific view of family. And we call that view a biblical view. Now at the moment, the biblical understanding of family and our specific view as Christians, it's quite a pressing subject in the world we live in. You guys know that the dynamics of families are impacted by the dynamics of culture. And even though the dynamics of culture have an impact on the dynamics of families, our biblical view of families won't change. And that's why it's such a pressing subject at the moment. That's why people talk about it so much, because people ask about it so much. Because if culture says this about family, what does the Bible say about it? And at the moment, the understanding of the Bible and what family entails, it's under fire from our culture. Culture wants to redefine it. Culture wants to change it. Now, you might not know this, or you might, but the family, the church, and the state are all institutions created by God for the flourishing of humanity. That means that God has a design for these three things. God has a will for these three things. And when we understand it and we live according to God's will for these three things, then we are living with wisdom. We have very specific instructions for these three institutions in the Bible. And that's important to note. Do you know that the Bible doesn't give you instructions on how to start a small business? The Bible doesn't give you instruction on how to start a hospital to serve the community. The Bible doesn't even tell you how to start a school and how to create curriculum. All things that are really important in our world, but the Bible doesn't tell us how to do it. But these three things, family, church, and state, the Bible actually says exactly what we need to do with them. And Proverbs gives us very practical guidelines on what to do and also what not to do. And the choice before us as we study what Proverbs says about family is the following. Wisdom or folly? You choose. If we choose wisdom, we can flourish and have an enjoyable family, even though we might go through times when things are going hard. If we choose folly, well, then we choose ruin and destruction. One question. How do I treat my family with wisdom and not folly? How do I treat my family with wisdom and not folly? I made it easy. I divided it into categories. If you are married, if you're a parent, if you're a child, and if you are a sibling, I promise there'll be something in my sermon for everyone. If you're married, here's how you do it. Keep your covenant and treasure your companion. If you're a parent, teach and discipline your children together. If you're a child, bring joy to your mother and father by living wisely. If you are a sibling, be united and be supportive. There we go. Now, I want to start today with a presentation of the gospel first. You guys know every single sermon we preach in this church, we at some point in the sermon present the gospel as the answer for what the text told us to do and to be. Usually I do that 3/4 of the way in or at the end of the sermon. But today I want to start with it. Okay, so let me remind you, God loves you. He loves you more than words could describe. He loves you more than you could ever imagine. He loves you so much that He sent His only Son for you, not His only Son, to suffer as a substitute for our salvation, to pay the price for our sin, and to bring us back to Him. We respond to the gospel by repenting, by turning away from our sinful ways and turning towards God, because now we are reconciled to Him. We receive His forgiveness, and we remember His grace, and His mercy, and His love, and His kindness, and His goodness. He embraces us like His own child. When He looks at us of our sins, He thinks no more. He gives His Spirit to live inside of us, and then He transforms us into the image of His Son. That is the good news. You can become a child of God the Father through His Son Jesus Christ by admitting your sin, by believing in Jesus, and by confessing Him as your Lord and Savior. It's really as easy as that. By grace, through faith. That's the good news. We say it every week because you who are a Christian need to hear it. And you who are not a Christian also need to hear it. Every single day. Now, why do I start my sermon about family with the gospel? Because I want you to know that the gospel gives us an imagination for family. It's like a taste test. You know, if someone gives you something to taste and they say, look for the zest of the lemon, but also the acidity of the balsamic and the smoothness of the olive oil and then the punch of the black pepper. Okay, so as you taste this piece of fillet, look for these things. What do? You taste the fillet and you go, there it is. You know what I mean? It's like I'm helping you to understand what you should look for. And then when you taste it, you actually taste the things that you're supposed to look for. So when we think about the gospel, when we think of God the Father, we have to have a picture of Him as the ultimate parent. The ultimate parent. When we think of Jesus Christ and the Holy Spirit, we should have a picture and an imagination of the ultimate covenantal companion. The Bible describes Jesus as our brother, as our friend, there through thick and thin. The Bible says that we were orphaned, we had no one, and we became sons who can expect a full inheritance. All of that is good news. In a billion years, we'll still be brothers and sisters. Think about that. I know that's sometimes hard to imagine, especially if you don't like the other people in the church. But you should just start liking them, because we'll be together for billions and billions and billions and billions of years. That's all great news. All because of God's great love. So if we have that vision, then that enables us to live in our current families, with all its sin and with all its brokenness. Are you guys with me? Let's do the first one. If you're married, keep your covenant and treasure your companion. One verse, Proverbs 2 verse 17, talks about adultery. And then it says why adultery is so terrible. And here's the reason. Because adultery, speaking of the adulterer, is someone who forsakes the companion of her youth and forgets the covenant of her God. Marriage, according to Proverbs, is all about covenant and companionship. Marriage matters because the Bible begins with marriage and the Bible ends with a wedding. Marriage was God's idea. So the question that we have to ask if we want to be wise in it is, what does He desire from it? And what He desires from it is covenant and companionship. So if we move away from it, you're busy with folly, you fool. If we move towards it, we are busy being wise. Why covenant and companionship? Well, covenant means that you promised something to someone. And when I say the word marriage, and you're a married person, that is the thing you should think of. Well, actually, a good test would be to ask, what do you think of when someone mentions the word marriage? And this counts for the single folks as well, you know. Do you think of holidays, great retirement, great sex, good meals, kids, a house, an estate somewhere? All of those are the wrong things to think about when you think about marriage. Because marriage is about the thing that you promised to someone else. That's wisdom. So what do you think of? What do your friends think of? What keeps you in a marriage is covenant. Marriage is more than these two things, covenant and companionship, but it's definitely not less. So do you view marriage as a covenant relationship or do you view it as a consumer relationship? If you view it as a consumer relationship, you are busy with folly. It will lead you to ruin. The moment your partner doesn't give you what you want your partner to give you, you are going to get out of it. In a covenant relationship, the covenant takes priority over your preferences. I chose this and therefore I will stay. Do you guys know that there are research that says that 6 out of 10 couples are unhappy within the first 5 years of their marriage? Research also says that not all of those people get divorced. Well, why not? Because what keeps you in marriage is the bond you made in blood in front of God and in front of other people. That's what keeps you in your marriage. And that's why people statistically move past the unhappy phases and through the unhappy phases, especially when they hit them again and again and again and again. Fam, think of Jesus Christ on the cross. There he is, naked and beaten up on the point and verge of death. Does he look at humankind in front of him and go, you have a lot going for you, you know. Very attractive. I can see myself being with you at some point. That's why I'll stay. Is that what he's thinking? Jesus looks at humankind in agony and sees how they betray him. Crucify him! Crucify him! They shout. And then they all run away. But luckily, Jesus stayed. Luckily, Jesus didn't say, fam, take me off this cross, I'm done, these people are not worth dying for. Luckily, he didn't do that. Why? Because he made a new covenant. And because he stayed, and because he died, and because he paid, and because he rose from the dead, we have life. Praise Jesus for the fact that he stayed. We're so glad that he did. Think of the beginning of the Bible story. In the garden, we find Adam, top man, with God, doing the job that he was assigned for. And then God says in Genesis 2:18, it's not good for man to be alone. Why? Because we were made in God's image, we were made for relationship, and we were created for fellowship. So even before the fall, before sin entered the world, man needed something. He lacked something. Even though he was in perfect harmony with God. I mean, think about that. You live in a paradise in perfect harmony with God, but it's still not enough. You need a friend. You need a companion. This is the woman speaking in the Song of Solomon. Look at this beautiful verse. Song of Solomon 5:16. His mouth is most sweet, and he is altogether desirable. What a gent. He doesn't smell like garlic, and his hair looks all bushy and weird. Katie entered the bathroom this morning, and she's like, Dad, why do you always try and make your hair look so perfect? And I'm like, dude, because I have to take care of myself, you know? If I don't do it, no one's going to do it. She goes, yeah, sure. Leaves again. I mean, this guy had some Colgate going there. Product in the hair, smellies on the neck. And look what she says. This is my beloved and this is my friend. O daughters of Jerusalem. Your spouse is to be your dear companion, fam. That's the biblical vision of marriage. Your spouse is more than a best friend, but it's definitely not less than a best friend. Marie and I were really good friends before we started a romantic relationship. We went on a short-term outreach to Botswana in 2009, and we couldn't leave with the bus. I had to leave later, and she also had to leave later. So I had the privilege of having her in the car with me for 1,000 kilometers, Pretoria to Khansi. Fam, it was an unbelievable road trip for 1,000 kilometers. Talking. It was brilliant. And I remember when we got to Khansi, I went, look, this young lady does have a lot going for her, but we could be friends, you know. She's really, really cool. And then I did what most Christian gentlemen do. You start Christian flirt. It's very subtle, very subtle. So I gave her a little pet name. I called her Kudu. And she called me Quagga. And once the pet name takes, you know, you are in. And I mean, we've been married for 12 and a half years now, you know, so Kudu and Quagga are still going strong. The question is, though, according to the wisdom of the Proverbs, are you cultivating good companionship, fam? Are you spending time to be intimate with each other in a deep way? Are you serving each other? Are you showing affection to each other? Are you talking to one another? And are you listening to one another? And are you intentional about all of these things? Do you uphold virtues like honesty, transparency, and forgiveness in your marriage? That's how you live with wisdom in marriage, you know. Now, I would love to give some advice on how to choose a spouse, seeing that we have a lot of single folk in the house. But I will let Proverbs do that. So most of the remaining Proverbs about marriage talk about how to choose a spouse. And every time it talks about the blessing of a good choice and the burden of a wrong choice. Let's look at the first one, Proverbs 12:4. An excellent wife is the crown of her husband, but she who brings shame is like rottenness in his bones. Ooh, the blessing of a crown and the serious burden of rot. Now remember, fam, that the Proverbs was written from a dad to a son. That's why it's all written then about the wife. But this is really one of those times where we can just exchange wife and husband, okay? So you can read it, an excellent husband is the crown of a wife. You can read it that way. See, this is all about private and public honoring of each other. Private and public tenderness toward each other. It's really devastating in a marriage if you are one person in public and another person in private. I think you said on Thursday that private victory precedes public victory. Did you say it? Yeah, you did. You did. That's really true, you know. Your marriage will flourish in public if your marriage flourishes in private. So can you show tenderness when no one else is looking? Can you honor your spouse when no one else is looking? I don't know if you even know this, but the words, I love you, doesn't get you to 75 years. The words, thank you, get you to 75 years. I'm serious. Research shows that the most said things between couples who stay together until right to the end are people who actually say thank you to each other. Thank you for sorting out the mountain of laundry. I really, really appreciate that. Thank you for washing the dishes. Thank you for taking out the trash. Thank you for taking the kids to where they ought to be. Thank you for not throwing me under the bus when you could have. Thank you for kissing me when my breath smells. Thank you for dealing with me when I've had garlic. You know what I mean? Simple stuff. But it's private honoring and it's public honoring. Look at Proverbs 31:11. The heart of her husband trusts in her, and he will have no lack of gain. Inconsistency leads to a lack of trust. And once you lose trust in a relationship, you'll never be satisfied in marriage. And inconsistency is a real killer of trust, you know. When you blow hot and cold, the one day you are awesome and the next day you are the antithesis of it. It leaves your spouse in a really tough spot because now I actually don't know who I'm dealing with here. It's like a lucky draw on the day. Consistency goes a really, really long way and it creates trust. Look at these proverbs from 19 all the way down. House and wealth are inherited from fathers, but a prudent wife is from the Lord. Proverbs 18:22, he who finds a wife finds a good thing and obtains favor from the Lord. Proverbs 31:30, charm is deceitful and beauty is in vain, but a woman who fears the Lord is to be praised. Three C's really, if you want to choose a spouse. Christ, Christ follower, and counsel. Christ first. Do you see that a good spouse is from the Lord? So everyone in the house looking for a spouse, ask the Lord Jesus. This is my need, this is my desire, and I know that the Bible says that if I do get one, he or she will come from you. That's really easy. You guys might not know this of our story, but in the August of 2010, one of my friends walked up to me. He actually preaches at this church from time to time, and he said, Brits, my second name is Brits, you have to marry Mossy. So Marie's maiden surname was Mostert. Okay? So I floated that pet name in there first. And once that took, then we went to Kudu and Kwaha. Point is, he said, Brits, you need to marry Mossy. And I said to him, dude, I will gladly marry her if the Lord tells me. It's as easy as that. I'm banking on him to give me a spouse. So if he says, that's your wife, I'm in. And then he said, that's your wife. And then I said, I'm in. And here we are today. So that's the first thing. Second thing, look for a Christ follower. Look for someone filled with the Spirit and bearing fruit. Look for someone who doesn't only profess his faith, but who also possesses his faith. All of y'all rolling on dating apps, if a guy says he's a Christian, it doesn't mean that he's a Christian, you know. You have to look for fruit. And the fruit's not ambiguous, it's not difficult. It's listed in the New Testament. There you go, all nine of them. And they're not ambiguous, you know. Love is love, and joy is joy, and patience is patience, and kindness is kindness. Look for that in your spouse. Is this person a real Christ follower? Because if they're not, get out. Because if they're a real Christ follower and they're not married, they will say that I am getting ready to be married. And then you look for beauty and physical attraction. And also remember, right, no one knows what I see when I look at Marie anyway. So what does it matter what anyone else says about her? According to me, fam, she is the most beautiful woman in the world. I can't believe it. I cannot believe that I get to be married to this woman. And also don't care what you think of me, because what she tells me, she thinks of me, that's all that matters in marriage. That's how it works. I have this vision of growing old with her. And I always say, and I've explained this to the kids as well, and they thought I was really weird, but teeth all yellow from all the coffee, hair really big because I'm old, nose even bigger than it is now because it keeps on growing, gray hair popping out of this bad boy, but I'm not trimming it anymore because I can't see, triceps all wobbly like bread dough, hands all see-through and blue because I'm old, and then I want to say, good morning, Odi. Like, that's the vision. That's where we want to go. Because our beauty will not last forever. You can't choose. You can't choose a spouse on those grounds. Think of counsel. As a Christian, if you're looking for a spouse, the best thing you can do is to ask your trusted brothers and sisters, what do you think? And to ask some married folk, what do you think? This is what church family is for, you know. And you need that because you've got no idea what's going to happen to you once you get married. You've got no clue. Everything changes. Everything. Your time, your money, your stuff, the questions you ask, your priorities, everything changes. Remember the gospel lens here. Jesus gave everything first. And that's why when we married and we believe that we should live in our marriage according to the gospel, then that's what all of us are called for, you know. Jesus didn't come to be served, but to serve. Jesus bowed down on his knees like I showed last week in humility, and he washed feet. That's what marriage is about. And you need married folk to tell you that. And you also need married folk sometimes to say, I just can't see the fruit, you know. You say you do, but I don't. Do you mind showing me? If you're married, keep your covenant, treasure your companion. Let's go to the second one. If you are a parent, teach and discipline your children together. Don't leave kids by themselves, fam. They need your help. They need our help. Kids won't figure it out. And don't outsource the parenting of your kids to someone else. Do not let someone else raise your children. They were given to you because God in His sovereign wisdom thought that you are the best mom and dad for those kids. Proverbs 29:15. The rod and reproof give wisdom, but a child left to himself brings shame to his mother. If you do nothing and you allow a kid to figure it out, they will bring shame to you. Proverbs 22:6, train up a child in the way he should go. Even when he's old, he will not depart from it. That's a beautiful promise now, isn't it? We say to our kids, we are Jesus' people. So this is how we roll. So this is the way in which we go, and this is the way in which you will go. And we are really firm in that. Proverbs 1:8. Hear, my son, your father's instruction, that's an important word, and forsake not your mother's teaching. Two different words used for instruction and teaching. Proverbs 6:20, my son, keep your father's commandment, another word used, and forsake not your mother's teaching. I say teach and discipline your children together. That means be involved, be together, and be united. That's how we ought to teach. Discipline requires communication, and it requires correction. I think we place a lot of emphasis on correction, and we'll get there now. But I think we should place a little bit more emphasis on communication. We need to communicate to the hearts of our children. Because everything we do comes from the heart, you know. We don't want to just modify our kids' behavior. We want to transform and change their behavior. We live in a really odd world where I feel like the only thing we are trying to do is make our kids safe. But what we should actually be aimed to do is to make our kids obedient to God and to His Word. There's a real difference there, you know. It's not that difficult to keep kids safe, but it's not enough. Our kids are not antiques that needs to be kept safe, but they are actually arrows that need to be launched. So yelling and barking at your kids and spanking them when they do the wrong things won't get to the heart. Remember the gospel lens here. How does God discipline you? Does He yell and bark at you and then spank you and then leave you? No, God speaks to the heart. He speaks to our deepest needs and our deepest desires and our deepest sin. And He speaks to us tenderly. It's His kindness that leads us to repentance. So having dialogue with your kids is really, really important if you want to instruct them well. Read Bible together. And then talk about the Bible that you just read together. And do it around the table. Most of the times, when our dinner time slips way too long and the kids end up getting too late in bed, it's because we had a discussion about the Bible and faith. And I always say to the kids, fam, we can't do 15 questions tonight, but we can do 3. And then I just indulge it, you know. Oh, it's the 15th question about Jonah, but okay, so remember this way around. I love it. And it's not that difficult. Take their questions when they ask them. Bring up questions when you have them. Work through a book of questions if you need it. Tell stories. Chat to them in the car. Don't be busy on your telephone or on the radio. The other night I was telling a story to our kids of God providing for us. And as I was busy telling the story, I said, fam, you guys know that we need money to fix our Run-X. And at the moment, we don't have enough money to fix the Run-X. Katie goes, hey, Dad, I've got 19 rand in my wallet. She goes, can I give that to you? Will that help? What a beautiful heart. And I went, Katie, you actually don't have to because listen, God provided for us. Someone called me and asked what you needed. I told them what we needed and they gave it to us and therefore we can fix the Run-X. And the kids go, this is awesome. Is that how it works? You can even ask God for someone to fix the Run-X. And I said, yeah, we can. Because there was something that we really needed, but we didn't have the money for it. Conversation, communication. I heard this list of questions from Tony Merida. And Tony Merida said that he can't remember where he heard it. So I'm quoting someone who quoted someone, but none of us can tell you where these questions come from. But it's really good questions. Think about questions like this. Just ask your children, what are we currently learning? What are we currently learning? As we are reading and as we are talking. Ask your children this. Is there something specific you are struggling with that you need my help with? Are you more aware of my encouragement or of my criticism? What do you hear more from mom or dad? Criticism or encouragement? This is a ripper. What is mom and dad most passionate about? Am I the same at church as I am at home? That's a goodie. Do you know how much I love you? Do you know how much I love you? Great question to ask your kids. Is there a way I have sinned against you that I have not yet repented of? I might have hurt you. I might not have said sorry yet. Can you help me? Does my relationship with mom make you excited about being married? That's a good one to ask our daughters. And then Marie can ask them the same. Does my relationship with Dad make you excited about being married? That will lead to some solid communication, you know. And that will lead to some heart chats. So we've got communication, but we also have correction. Let's look at this series of Proverbs, 13:24. Whoever spares the rod hates his son, but he who loves him is diligent to discipline him. Fam, discipline is needed and it works. But don't be inconsistent. Because if you're inconsistent, you exasperate your kids. And I've used this example before. You're busy with something that's important to you, whatever it is. And the kids act out. So today, you're just going to let it slide. Because I'm busy with something. But then tomorrow, you're not. And the kids are acting out. And then you come down on them like a ton of bricks. The whole spiel. Chores, consequences, timeouts, and a spanking. And then the kids go, my word, we did exactly the same yesterday. And you were really chilled. What on earth is going on? That's the hardest part of parenting, is always being diligent. Because now you're watching the box thrash the wallabies and you go, so good, this. Go Sasha, go Sasha. It's all right. But then tomorrow it's not. We shouldn't be that way. Look at Proverbs 22:15. Folly is bound up in the heart of a child, but the rod of discipline drives it far from him. Ah, fam, your kids are so cute at first. And then they start moving. And then you think, you fool. Why would you eat the mud? It's so silly. Why would you stick your finger in that place where you shouldn't? Why did you go to the place that I've repeatedly told you not to go? It's because folly is bound up in the heart of your child. And the way that you make a child stop is by disciplining them. Proverbs 23, do not withhold discipline from a child. If you strike him with a rod, he will not die. They won't, I promise. If you strike him with a rod, you will save his soul from Sheol. 29:17, discipline your son and he will give you rest. He will give delight to your heart. There's a real reward there, you know. And when you do discipline, also do the gospel. Explain to your children why this thing that they did was sin. And explain to them what sin does. And then explain to them that sin breaks down relationships and the only way that relationships can be repaired is by forgiveness and by renewal and by giving grace. And then explain to them that the same way that God gives me grace is the way in which I give you grace. When I sin, God forgives me, so I am now forgiving you. When I repent, God welcomes me with open arms and therefore I will now welcome you with open arms. After you've whipped out the rod, hugs should actually follow, you know. Because that's the way in which you renew the relationship. You can't keep on yelling and barking after the rod came out. Do the gospel when you discipline your kids. 3, if you are a child, bring joy to your mother and father by living wisely. Now remember, whatever your age is, whatever your age are, is tall. Whatever your age is, if you have parents, you're still a kid, you know. I remember when I was 18 and my mom said to me, my boy, just remember, you'll always be my child. I thought, nee, nee, nee. I'm 18 now, I'm going to Scotland. I'm going to live on my own. And now that I have kids, I go, you guys will always be my kids. I'm turning 40 next year and I'm still my mom's kid, you know. Still my dad's boy. It's not going to change. My grandma's still alive at 97, so my dad at 69 is still a son, you know. The Proverbs of Solomon, 10:1. A wise son makes a father glad, but a foolish son is a sorrow to his mother. 15:20. A wise son makes a glad father, but a foolish man despises his mother. 29:3, he who loves wisdom makes his father glad, but a companion of prostitutes squanders his wealth. Oh, the late Tim Keller once said this, and I believe him. I mean, I always believe what he says, but he said, Parents can only be as happy as their unhappiest child. Yeah, that's a tough one. But it's true. Parents can only be as happy as their unhappiest child. So fam, maybe today, if you are a kid, give your parents, if you still have them, a call. And thank them. And encourage them. They will be encouraged, you know. And their hearts will be glad. After I got saved, the very first thing that I said to my mom was sorry. I just felt the Spirit say to me. The guy who shared the gospel with me said, you will now feel the Spirit of God inside of you and you should obey right away. And I went, okay. And then I went home and I felt the Spirit of God tell me, say sorry to your mom. And that's exactly what I did. That day, fam, weeping pools of tears. I just said, Mom, I'm really sorry. I'm so sorry for everything that I did to you and how I acted towards you. What on earth was I thinking? And I felt the Spirit of God tell me to say sorry to you. And she was weeping pools of tears because she's been praying for me for all of those years, you know, and all of my rebellion. When we talk about parenting, think how God treats you and treat your children accordingly. It's His kindness that leads us to repentance, His steadfastness, His faithfulness, His grace and His mercy. Last one. If you are a sibling, be united and be supportive. Only two proverbs that I want to show you. Proverbs 6 says, there are six things that the Lord hates. Seven that are an abomination to Him. And then he ends with the seventh one. One who sows discord among brothers. If you're a sibling, be united with your family. I know that all of us can point fingers and say, yeah, but you don't know what he did. You don't know what she did. No family in this room has got it all together. But wisdom says, I'm not going to do it. Do you see it? Wisdom says, I will not sow discord among my brothers. I'm not going to be divisive. I'm rather going to be a uniting relationship. And once again, remember the gospel lens here. We are all family, and we've been reconciled to one another. And Ephesians 2 says we now live in a bond of peace and unity with each other. That's why we go for it. And look at Proverbs 17:17. A friend loves at all times, and a brother is born for adversity. Fam, if you have siblings, you ought to be there when they are in trouble. And they ought to be there for you when you are in trouble. That's what siblings are for. I'm with you. And I will support you in whatever it is that you're going through. So if you have siblings today, maybe call them as well and say, yeah, cheers. Thank you. I'm really encouraged by the way that you've always been there for me. I've got two brothers, one older and one younger. My older brother is a champ. And he was so kind to me as we grew up. I'm 2 years younger than he is. He was just really a good older brother. Never selfish. Always trying to help me to understand what we're busy with. Always keen to say, okay, let's play a little bit of this and then play a little bit of that. My mom tells me this story that when we were in nursery school, I can't remember it. I was too traumatized. No, I'm joking. I was sick one day and I was crying and my brother stood on the other side of the fence. You know how they separate kids at a nursery school, like the really small ones here and the little bigger ones here. My brother stood at the fence with his hand through the fence and he held my hand the whole day. And I was standing there the whole day. But he was there for me. Supporting me. Unbelievable, right? That's how we rolled. I'm going to call him today and say thank you once again, and then we're going to have a laugh, and it's going to be good. Wisdom or folly when it comes to family? When we do family in light of the gospel, then we'll do family with wisdom. Amen. If you're married this morning, you might be really challenged to keep your covenant. And you might be really challenged to treasure your companion. You might also need to repent for the ways in which you might have forgotten it or for which in the ways that you might not have treasured your companion. If you're a parent, it might be that you revise the way that you teach, and that you revise the way that you discipline, and that you also have a conversation with your spouse, if you are co-parenting with someone, to say, hey, we need to do this together, you know. Maybe if you're a single parent, the application or the response would be to look for someone to help you to parent your kids, because you can't do it alone. If you're a child, just a simple decision by bringing joy to your mother and father by living wisely, that's a good thing to do. And then also, if you are a parent of smaller children who are not in the hall at the moment, you can take this podcast afterwards and then you can play them just that little section and say, hey, Uncle Reino has got a message for you. Listen, okay? Bring joy to your parents by living wisely. And if you're a sibling, maybe there's some sorries that needs to be said. Or maybe there's some desires that needs to be spoken. You might not have done something wrong and they might not have done something wrong. But what if your response today is just to say, I want to be closer to you and I want to be more supportive of you in whatever it is that you're going through? That might also be a response. Maybe your response is, Father God, once again model perfect parenthood to me. Jesus Christ, remind me what it's like to be a covenantal companion. Holy Spirit, teach me these things over and over and remind me that I'm God's child. Whatever it is, I want to give a time for response. I want you to think through it. I'll do a prayer for us and we'll respond in worship. Father God, we thank you for family. We thank you that you are our dad. We thank you for your covenantal love that you show towards us. We thank you, Jesus, for your companionship, the fact that we have a friend in you. We thank you for the privilege of being part of a colossal family of faith in which we can have a lot of siblings. We thank you for the way in which you treat us. And we thank you for moments like these that we can attentively listen to your Spirit and respond accordingly. I want to pray, Father God, for courage for us to take that step of obedience that you are calling us to. And that we will gladly and willingly say yes to what it is that you ask of us. We desire to see healthy families in this church. We desire to see healthy families in our community. We desire to see people on a journey of healing towards wholeness. We desire to see, Lord Jesus, how the kingdom of darkness gets pushed back by your people living according to your will, to your word, and to your purposes. And we know that healthy families are a beautiful testimony of your goodness and kindness and your love. I want to pray for all the broken hearts in this place. Because I know that every time I say family, some hurt pops up somewhere. Thank you that we can trust you for healing. And that we can trust you for wholeness. Even in spite of all the brokenness that we've experienced. May your name be glorified through our relationships, Lord Jesus, we pray. Amen.